Over a communication channel, position data gets sent to the teleoperator, and the teleoperator can manipulate the environment, and with sensors he can recognize these changes in the environment, and this gets transferred back to the operator side. And using special displays, like for example a monitor as a visual display, he can, for example, see what's happening on the other side, or with haptic displays like force feedback joysticks or stuff like that. This. Okay.
So now we are prepared to we know all the concepts, so we can have a look at history. And this is a very early telerobotics device. It's called Handyman, and it's an exoskeleton for the arms and the upper body. So you can move your arms, and the exoskeleton recognizes these movements, and the movements are transferred to robotic arms. And also in these early days, this device included also a force feedback channel. So if you apply the force on the robotic arm, you could feel the force in the exoskeleton. This device served two main purposes. The first was to scare the children, as you can see. And the main purpose was to handle dangerous chemical substances. So this device was invented to operate a laboratory from the outside and not to get endanger itself.
So this was to overcome the barrier of danger. And
the same is true for this case. So 1986, there was the disaster beyond all expectations in Chernobyl, and you can see there are on the roof, and there are 500 Röntgen. This means it's 4.66 sieverts. So this means if you are there for a few seconds or minutes, you are most likely to die within the next 30 days. And so they used a tele-prison system here, you can see, to remove the trash from the roof. But unfortunately, the radiation was so high that the moon rover here from the GDR stopped working. It was prepared against this radiation, but it wasn't enough. So, what they did was to send so-called biorobots or liquidators, so humans not really shielded against the radiation, and they were allowed or forced to go there for 20 or 30 seconds to remove one or two shovels of trash away from the roof, and of course they were harmed. In history, telesurgery is another example. 2001, the Lindbergh operation. So the surgeon sat in Europe, and he operated all the women in the USA on the hips. And the good news is she survived. And the main challenge here was that they had to struggle with, of course you can imagine, with delays about when it comes to transferring the signals to the US, and they only had 10 megabits available for the bandwidth. Okay, so, but now let's go to the Now robot.
Yeah, and now we're talking about which technology we use to build our project. And of course, the most important one is the robot. And we have here a humanoid robot. It was manufactured by Aldebaran Robotics. That's a French company. It was acquired by SoftBank, a Japanese company, in 2013. And this robot is already over 10 years, has over 10 years of history. So that's what it looked like in the first prototype. So you can only recognize the legs over there. And only the last three iterations look similar to the model we have now. The model on the right, the last one, is the first one that was actually built in series. So the first copies were delivered to the RoboCup Challenge, so robot soccer. And they replaced there the Sony Aibo robot dog, if you might know it, if you remember that. And so that was the original purpose for this robot. But we, of course, used it in a different way.
Yeah, so let's talk about the features of the Now robot. So we have two speakers so that the Now can communicate with us. He has a text-to-speech feature, so for different language packages, for up to 30 languages, I think. And we have two RGB cameras. We can't see them right now because of our special gloves here, glasses. We have tactile sensors. We have four microphones in it. These are four because we want to identify the direction where audio comes from, where audio signals coming from. We have a battery included, so the Now can run standalone for up to, I would say, 3 to 4 hours. And yeah, we have sonars to recognize objects coming into the direction of the Now. And communication is done over Ethernet or Wi-Fi connection.
Okay, so now what we want to do is to control the movements of the robot. So if you just unwrap it, buy it, unwrap it, it has some autonomous mode enabled, so it can walk around and look around by itself, but that's not what we want to do. We want to control it manually, and there is a low-level and a high-level API for that. This is the high-level API. You can put the robot into several poses, and you can get from each of these poses to an arbitrary other one just by one command, and the robot will know by himself how to move his joints to get into this pose. Lying back and lying belly is rather important because it falls over quite often if you don't care, or even if you care. And then you can just put it back into stand or stand in it pose and it will get up on its own. This doesn't work as well if you put cables and stuff around as we did, but usually this works pretty good. Then there's also the low-level API, and for that you have 26 degrees of freedom you can control, and you have lots of joints, and they are just like the human joints. They are it's adapted from the human body, so you can see in the knee you have only 1 degree of freedom, but in the hip you have 3 degrees of freedom, just like humans have. The only thing where I don't have that much degrees of freedom is in the hands, so you can only open and close the hands, but you cannot control single joints on the fingers. This is the degrees of freedom for the left arm, and you can see here for a single joint, we identify the joint, and then we have a name for the angle. So we have a roll for the shoulder like this. We have yaw. This is like this, and we also have pitch, so move a joint like this. So if you're a pilot, you probably know these names because it's taken from aviation. If you're not a pilot, it's no problem because this is from the official documentation, so it's all very well documented. You can just look it up, and you don't have to remember that. Okay, so now let's do short live demo.
Yeah, I mean, now we want to start. We want to describe how to make the configuration for the Now. So you want to continue? Or?
Yeah, sure. So not the live demo quite yet, but in a few slides. So this is how you control the robot in Python. To send commands to the robots, we have different types of dynamic proxies. They are all instantiated as AL proxies, and depending on the type of proxy you pass as first argument, you get a different proxy, and you can call different methods on it. So we have we already had that, the speech proxy, the audio proxy. You can play WAV files, you can send text to the robot, and he will speech synthesize it. Okay, better than me probably. We also have a posture proxy. This is for the high-level movement API, so you can put the robot in different postures, like stand up, crouch. And we have the motion proxy, and this is for the low-level movement. So we tell the robot, put this joint at angle X or whatever. So now let's have a look how this works. So this is now Martin coding Python for the first time. So first, we need to instantiate these proxies. I don't know if they are shown on this slide. Okay, so what we want to do now is we want to move some of the joints of the robot into a specific position. To do that, Which movie is this? Ah, perfect. Yeah. So the young people don't know this anymore. It's a shame. So okay. So what we need for this is we need the names of the joints first.
Right. So we have to. I think you want to say that or.
Just write it.
Okay. Position. And for this we have to declare an array of with the names of those joints. And in this case, these are the left joints, and as we want to control both arms, we have to do the same for the right joints. Okay. After that, we have to declare another array with the values of the position data. As we already mentioned, in the documentation, you can find the information about the values for the different joints, which values are allowed. And in this case, we have those numbers 2, minus 1.5 and 0.6. So you have to just have a look into the documentation, and then you will have a feeling which values are allowed for the different joints. And of course, we have to do this again for the right angles as well. Okay, after we set everything up, by the way, maybe you recognize that there is a difference between the left angles and the right angles. This is just because that the values are somehow there are mirrored from the left and the right side, of course. And Thomas, can you please have a look?
Okay. Awesome. Take care.
So after this is done, we now use the motion proxy. You already saw that when we did our configuration. And there is a method called zAngles. And there we say left joints, the left angles. And now you can see 0.5. The 0.5 is just the speed. You can have a speed of 0, so it's a very slow movement. And if you make set up the speed to 1, it's really fast. You have to be careful. The faster the movements are, the more likely it is that you will fall down. Yeah. Okay, we do this for the right joints as well. Yeah, and yeah, that's it, I would say. Okay. I will add another command. We make a sleep, and we will call the method rest. This is really important because if we are using the motion proxy and we get into a special position, there is power on the motors, and the longer he stays in a position, the motors can get hot. Yeah. So you call the rest command so that the power, the voltage is resetted, and then the stiffness is zero. You know. Okay. So let's try it. So as this is live coding, okay. I press execute, and hopefully it works.
Cool.
So after the 2 seconds, seconds, everything is fine, it's rested, and I will show you something, I will execute it again. It's stiff, yeah? So when the motion proxy is called with those different parameters, the stiffness is 1. And with the rest command, the stiffness is 0. So the voltage, there's no voltage on the motors. This is important because if we don't do that, the now starts to complain, hey, my motors are getting too hot, and we want to avoid that during the talk. Okay. And now we want to show you the whole showcase.
And for that, Thomas is setting up, but you have to switch to VGA right now, please. And now we show you the out-of-body experience, so the whole implementation of the showcase. And so Thomas is now wearing the special prepared Oculus Rift. And one moment, just to go for sure that nothing happens right now. So this is an Oculus Rift, and there are two RGB cameras attached to it. The idea behind that is that Thomas just can still see me, yeah, because he has to coordinate himself to stay in front of the Kinect and everything, yeah, so it's a good idea if it's not black inside the Oculus. Okay, so he will do a circle gesture with the left hand clockwise, and then his consciousness gets transferred into the Now robot. The Now robot has a stereo camera attached, and he will film the environment. He will actually see you. This video signal gets transferred back to Thomas into the Oculus, and he will see you from this point of view in 3D. Okay? Okay, let's try it. So this is a live showcase, and it's tech porn actually, and we hope it works. Yeah, the circle gesture. Yeah, you will do it. I'm quite sure. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Yeah. So maybe you can a wink to the audience, for example. Yeah. So hello, hello. Oh, the video signal is a little bit laggy. I don't know why, but yeah. And Thomas, of course, you can walk as well. Maybe you want to show that? Okay. Yeah, it's working. You can stop. Okay, awesome, awesome. I think now it's time that we can stop the demo, and where is the red button? Oh my god, it's there. Can somebody press the red button? I don't want to cross the Kinect. Emergency. Yeah, awesome. Thank you, thank you. Okay, it's always good if everything works fine, except the stuttering video signal, but this was one of our main challenges here. Yeah, okay. As you maybe noticed, the walking gesture, so the bottom part of the body, we don't translate the body the leg movements one-to-one to the Now, because it will fall down. So this is the reason why we are only recognizing a walking gesture, and then we start a macro on the Now, and there is a balance manager inside, and so the Now walks and it's somehow stable, and that's fine. Okay, so let's get back to our presentation. Yeah, so you maybe remember this slide about multimodal telepresence. So now this is our implementation on the operator side. Instead of using a joystick or a keyboard or a mouse, we have a Kinect 3D camera. This project works as well with inter-real sense, of course. All our communication is done over a Wi-Fi channel, and the teleoperator is this little guy. And yeah, with he can manipulate the environment, he can grab things, for example. We just forgot to show that, but anyway. And the RGB signal, for example, the video camera gets transferred back and is shown in an Oculus Rift and on a laptop monitor, of course. You may ask yourself, why do we have a stereo camera attached on it? Because the Now has two cameras already implemented. The reason for that is that the Now robot, the cameras, the two cameras are vertically aligned. This is okay if you make those robo cups, where the Now is used. One camera looks downside and the other forward. And but this is not good for us. We want a 3D perspective, a stereoscopic image, so we attached a horizontal aligned stereo camera.
Okay, that was the hardware architecture, and let's now have a short look at the architecture of the software we built. Most important, on the left side, we have the Kinect Steerer. This is a C-sharp program that runs on the laptop, and it gets the data from the Kinect and transforms this data into movement commands for the robot, quite similar to those we have seen in the live demo before. But we cannot talk to the Now API directly with C-sharp because the library is broken. So we have a Python relay, the Now controller, down on the right-hand side, and we transfer the movement commands via MQTT to a relay which runs on an extra machine somewhere in our box here, and this communicates with the Now key API we have shown you just before. Then, second most important, for the back channel, we have the stereo camera, and it is attached to a Raspberry Pi on the back. And the reason for that is that we couldn't manage to get the camera working. Wow, this is not good. Turn it off or something. we couldn't manage to connect our stereo camera to the USB port on the back, so we just use this for power now. It was some driver issues, so just another machine over there. And we use GStreamer to stream two video streams back over Wi-Fi to the Oculus Viewer. The Oculus Viewer is C-sharp again, and it runs also on the laptop, and it provides the image we saw in the Oculus Rift. And there's some more, but... Oh, yeah. That's not good. Okay. So that are the most important components. So I think we can go on. And so now we have seen one example of a current robot that you can buy. So you can buy one and have one of your own if you want. But that's not. It's already some years old, and it's not quite anymore the state of the art. So this is the Honda Azimo, and we will use this to show you an example of how walking is implemented. You have seen before, when I walked, the robot played back a macro. That's exactly how this robot works. He has walking also implemented by just replaying hard-coded macros. And if you don't like violence, you may want to shut your eyes now. This happens if there is only the slightest disturbance in how the robot walks these stairs, and then everything will fail and the robot will fall over. A much better approach is to use a dynamic walking algorithm, as the Boston Dynamics Atlas has. So he has sensors in his upper body and in his legs, and he uses the sensors to experience his environment and to dynamically react on uneven ground, on slippery ground. So he looks as he would have been at the Brauhaus yesterday, but it's a much more stable. It's much more stable than it looks. So you will see him slip, but he still continues to walk. He doesn't fall. You can also kick him and so on, and he will continue to walk. He will also not punch back yet. So that's how you are supposed to build something like this. But as it would probably also be much more expensive.
Yeah, you didn't know this slide. It's a new one. I've just added it at the last talk because it was published by The Guardian. As you see, not everything works perfect all the time. So this was a situation where the Atlas also lost his balance. So. Okay, so let's talk about a little bit of code and technology. So the Kinect One we used here, or the Intel RealSense.
Yes. So the Kinect One is a 3D camera. If you have visited the exhibition, you have seen lots of them. It uses an infrared laser to illuminate the scenery, and it uses a time-of-flight sensor to reconstruct a 3D depth map of the scenery. So it just measures the time a light travels from the Kinect to the scenery and back, and this is how it reconstructs the scenery. It also comes with a large software package that does all the heavy work for you, or the heavy lifting. So there is software included that does full skeleton tracking. So you get 26 joints of the human body. And from the API, you just get a list of 3D coordinates. So you don't have to worry about how to track a person. So this is how the raw data looks like. You can see you see just the joints. You can also detect if the hand is open or closed. And it works in real time and for up to 6 persons at the same time. There is also another product that does basically the same thing.
Okay. Yeah, so this is Intel RealSense. They also started in 2013 to build their own 3D cameras. So this is Intel RealSense. In Germany, you want to say Eierlegende Wollmilchsau, so egg laying Wollmilchpig, or something like that. So it can do speech recognition, face identification. It has a hand skeleton model. It can identify up to 22 joints of one hand, and So there is an example here as well. I hope it works. So,
hi.
Hi. So the Intel RealSense. Actually, I don't know. Does it work well if I have the microphone on my face? I can't see that right now.
Sort of. You have a long beard now.
Okay. So, 78 points are recognized by the Intel RealSense camera, which is directly built into my laptop here, and so this is one example of many, and they're really easy to use because. Those SDKs which are delivered, there are really, you don't need to be an expert with image processing. That's what I want to say. Yeah, and Intel plans to publish the Intel Euclid. They announced that in 2016. This is cool for IoT projects because instead of using the Microsoft Kinect, which weighs 1.5 kilograms with all the cables and stuff. The Euclid only weighs a few 100 grams, and everything is included. The processor, which is doing the image processing work, and there is also a battery so that it can run, let's say 4 hours or something like that. Yeah, so far. By the way, the Kinect, yesterday Microsoft announced that the Kinect development is stopped, and we will see what happens next.
So the third component we use in our setup is an Oculus Rift. We have the DK2, the develop kit number 2, and it's with the Oculus Rift. It's the same as with all the other components. They come with a very good SDK, and you can just use it. And we can show you one example how easy it is to use it. VR glasses are basically just a display very close to your face, and 2 very strong lenses in front of it. Because otherwise, if you put your hand like this, you cannot see it because it's blurred. So you need really strong lenses. But with these strong lenses, there come artifacts that you don't want to have. So you have chromatic aberrations, you have disparate distortion. Luckily, we have full control over the display, so we can compensate those effects beforehand by manipulating the image. And the nice part about this is you don't have to do it yourself because it's the same all the time. You just render the scenery like you would do for a regular 2D project, call one method to the SDK, and it does all that for you, and afterwards it looks just as it's supposed to be. We had also some, so that's like the technology we used, but Of course, it didn't go that well all the time, so we also had to face some challenges, and we just want to show you the two biggest challenges we had to solve to get this project working. The first one was bandwidth. So we have two video streams at the same time, and almost no compression. We use MJPEG to get a fast stream, and therefore we need a lot of bandwidth. And when we first switched on the video stream, the robot just stopped moving, because all the bandwidth was used up by the video signal. So we solved this as computer scientists too. Usually we just bought more hardware, and we built a custom router using the MikroTik routerbot platform, and it has now two access points. So if you scan, you will find two TNG Now access points, one only for video streaming and one for controlling the robot. The other problem we had was CPU speed, and yeah, it's a no-brainer. Just buy the biggest laptop you can afford and you're fine.
Okay, and so now we want to come to the fields of application. We don't have that much time. So this is an example, how you can use such robotics, telepresence robotics. Here you can see Da Vinci. When we held this talk in Boston, there was actually a guy where the father was operated by this machine because he had some kind of cancer. It was really important to make a not minimal invasive surgery. They had to do a micro-invasive surgery because there was the danger that the cancer will spread inside the human body. And with this machine, you are able to work much more precise than the human is able to do normally. And this is developed since 2000. Yeah, this is a project from the Deutsche Forschungszentrum für Künstliche Intelligenz in Bremen. And here they are using active exoskeleton to control the Carpio robot. The Carpio robot, you maybe can remember, it was one of our first slides, and there are here pushing the buttons. And this works as well with a passive exoskeleton. This is just an example how you can over-engineer things.
So, yeah, that's a very nice field of application. So imagine you have an immune disorder and you cannot attend school because like contact with other children would literally kill you. Then you can be happy if you have the opportunity to use a distance platform, a learning platform like Vigo. It allows you to take part in classes from remote, so you can also, you can drive around, you can speak, you can, your face is visible, and you have a camera, so you see everything. And it's very nice, because it's much better than an online learning platform, because you cannot only attend class, but you can also attend the social life around. When your class moves to the next room, you can just move with them.
So let's come to the conclusion of our project. When we had our hackathon in the Alps, we were able to realize the gesture control for the Now robot within one day. This was totally, it was really easy.
But only for one arm.
Yeah, okay. You know. You can extrapolate the stuff. Okay, so the main challenge we already told you was the video signal transmission stuff. But all in all, you can see that the Now robot is really easy to use. By the way, you can program it with Java and with C++, with JavaScript, and the .NET library was stopped. So we don't have that much. We don't have time. Yeah. So if you have any questions, feel free to come to us. We will just go out with all the stuff, and then you feel free to ask us questions. Thank you.
So thank you very much for this nice talk. I don't know, you have to go probably now. Yeah, okay. So please ask the questions to them. You have 5 minutes left.
Okay.
Okay. All right. So 5 minutes for questions, okay. Please.
Hello, just ask some questions because I saw the presentation. It's so interesting. The first one is, what is the maximum velocity of the hand robot can move? And sorry. Yeah. Yeah.
For the motion, for the remote control, you saw in the live demo this speed factor. We set it always to 1, so it cannot move faster than we showed you in the live demo.
Okay. So last time I saw the value is more than 0. So what happened if we put the value less than 0? It will rotate different the size as you want, or it's green. Ah, okay.
So, if you want to move backwards, so you always set the absolute position. So you set an angle and it moves to this position as fast as it can. It's different for the walking. So for the walking, I think you can actually move backwards, so with a negative speed. But only for the split and walking algorithm, but not for set for the low level LAPI where you set the angles.
Yeah.
Okay.
So
The last question here is, for example, I saw you have some like head, and then you teach the robots. For example, now you teach robot dance Michael Jackson. So you save the video, and next time you say with the robot, hey, please dance Michael Jackson, and how we can save the story like that.
Is there another short question? Then maybe I have one. Do you plan to include maybe haptic feedback so that users can?
We forgot. Very good question. Yeah, we already have, but the talk at the time is so short, so we didn't talk about it. We have a button over here on the top.
On the head. You can say.
And if you touch it, then you will feel here a small vibration. We have a vibration motor attached here. So it usually doesn't work, so we don't show it because it's...
Currently it works.
Oh, perfect. Yeah. So even better. So we built in that. It's not that useful because it's only one single point, but it's rather like to demonstrate the concept. Yeah.
All right, then unfortunately we have to stop now. So let's thank the speakers again.
Thank you.